The Northwestern Mutual Data Science Institute is a groundbreaking partnership between Northwestern Mutual, Marquette University, and the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee that contributes to the formation of a technology ecosystem and advances Southeastern Wisconsin as a national hub for technology, resource, business, and talent development. Our vision is to be a world-class institute that transforms our world through the power of data science. We inspire and cultivate passion for data science, galvanizing the brightest minds in the Milwaukee region to solve some of the world's most pressing problems and inspire the next generation of data scientists. Our focus is in three key areas: research, talent, and community, allows us to solve important business and community challenges by harnessing the power of data for research and scientific discovery, preparing the next generation of data science professionals to advance the region, and partnering with area nonprofit organizations to address issues facing some of the most vulnerable populations. You can learn about the NMDSI and get connected with us by signing for our distribution list by visiting our website, nmdsi.org. So today, it's my great pleasure to welcome Professor Prashenjit Neel Guptasarma. He's our speaker today. He serves as an associate Dean for Academic Affairs and is a professor of physics at UWM. His research has resulted in over 135 publications, including in journals with some of the highest impact factors. Dr. Guptasarma has given more than 90 invited lectures at conferences and institutes worldwide. His grant proposals have won several million dollars from competitive peer-reviewed US federal funding. Guptasarma directs a research lab in the Kenwood Interdisciplinary Research Complex on UWM's main campus. Over the years, Dr. Guptasarma has mentored and supported postdoctoral scientists, PhD students, undergraduate researchers, and high school students. He loves to teach both undergraduate and graduate classes and has taught at every level from college freshman to doctoral. Outside of academia, Dr. Guptasarma's interests include learning new languages, performing music, and theater. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Guptasarma to give his talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh, for this wonderful introduction. It's my pleasure to be here with you all, and thanks to the Data Science Institute for the invitation. I am, as Dr. Ghosh said, I am a professor of physics at the UW-Milwaukee, University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee, and I also serve as associate dean in the College of Engineering. So I'm hoping to bring both perspectives in this talk. But what I decided I will do when Dr. Ghosh first approached me was that I would give you a sense of how data science has evolved from the various sort of parent disciplines. And one of those disciplines is physics. So I want to tell you about that, this following fact, that if you think about it, modern data science, as is visualized by most people in the business world, is a sort of intersection of computer science or computation, of mathematics, statistics, and so on, and business sense, right? So we use computers, computation techniques, we use mathematics, and then we try to glean from that some intuitive understanding of where business is supposed to go. Let's say we could do something like, we could take what the inflation rates are, we could take things like how many people are employed currently, what's the unemployment rate. We could take things like that and we could put all those parameters together. And then at the end of it, we could say, the economy is going to look bad in the next 10 years, or the economy is going to look good in the next 10 years, or things like, let's go invest in bonds versus stocks. So these are decisions that people take in the business world or commercial world as to where, you know, how one can make money. So think about those three things that I said: computation, mathematics and the business sense. And if you replace that business sense with science, then that's where it all started. And where it really did start is with physics. So I've been talking about data science phase one or version one, and this is the picture that I wanted you to see when I talked about the stars in the sky. Do you see that, Rina?
Yes.
Okay, great. So this is what I wanted you to see when I was saying, imagine yourself thousands of years ago looking up at the night sky and wondering what those little dots were and trying to make sense of it. And the human mind always wants to make sense of what's going on. And in those early days, people figured out that these dots in the sky actually don't stay in the same place, they move. But the thing is that, of course, they move with the Earth, that is, the moon rises and sets and the sun rises and sets. But some of these stars, unless you're taking data day after day after day or hour after hour, you cannot tell that they're moving. And that's what they were doing. They were noticing, they were watching them for years and years, watching how a particular star moved in the night sky. And this was not even one generation. So several generations over several thousands of years. And so I wanted to show you this slide where, which did not show previously, that there were early civilizations such as those in India and in China and in Persia and Arabia, which did a lot of this and figured out many things such as what the diameter of the Earth is, you know, which stars are planets or which glowing things are stars and things like that. And they figured out that some of those move more than the others and that the planets seem to move a little bit more in the night sky than the rest of the night sky. And based on some of that, we can today predict when a certain thing was written. So you take an ancient script and you hear about how they described the sky at that time. And today we can compute what that sky should have looked at a certain point in time. And we can do astronomical history, basically, history based on astronomy and say, oh, this must have been written in the year 500 BC or in the year 2000 BC. So all of these people did that. And these are what we call early data scientists. So here is one big guy from one of those, maybe hundreds of people, generation after generation, collecting data from the sky and then trying to make some sense of it. And the picture you see is of Galileo, and that's a guy that was born somewhere in Pisa or Bologna. I've actually physically gone and seen his lab in Bologna in Italy. And so he didn't discover the telescope, but it is he's said to have been the first to point the telescope toward the sky. And today, of course, on the left side, you see this modern human being watching the sky with really significantly better telescopes than he had. But you see people around him here, he's showing the sky to some politician in the area trying to prove something. But behind him, you see these other younger and other people who were his followers. And these are people who had been taking data, sort of ancient data engineers, collecting data of the sky and then putting them together. And then this guy came by and said, oh, this is what it all means. So Galileo was one of the first people who did that. We think of him as the father of modern physics. And here were some of the earlier data scientists from Europe. So Copernicus and Tycho Brahe, anyone who's taken an early physics class would remember these names. And they came upon and said, oh, you know, this is either the sun goes around the earth or the earth goes around the sun, became a big controversy at that time. Tycho Brahe first said that, oh, you know what, the planets actually don't go around the sun, but they go around each other. So they actually, if you see my cursor here on the top right, you'll see some little circles drawn on the larger circles. And so he postulated that, oh, it's possible that the planets are actually going round and round on the bigger circle. And that was to explain why some planets seem to move in a certain direction in the night sky over days or months, and then they seem to trace backward. And they wondered, why does it trace backward? And so they had these years and years of data, and they were saying, why are these planets tracing backward and forward? And they said, oh, maybe because they're actually going around in little circles as they go around in the bigger circle. So all of this happened, and then there was this controversy about whether all of this is going around the sun or not. And at some point, Galileo claimed that everything is going around the sun. And he also claimed, based on his data, that if you drop two objects of different mass, they will fall to the ground at the same time. So here I'm showing you early data analytics of data collected by what we would call today data engineers. And if you look at the screens, these are three different manuscripts from the early 1400s and 1500s. So you see them taking data about where the stars are positioned. And in the middle, you see, you know, how the stars are moving with respect to the sun, et cetera. And if you think about it, that's what these guys are doing in the early Chinese texts as well. They're saying, oh, I saw this thing here and it's moving like that. So that's how they took data in, you know, on those pieces of cloth. So that was sort of early data analytics from the 1400s to the 1600s when people started to make sense of it, from which modern mathematics grew. And so a lot of these people whom I'm describing, they are the ones who actually came up with these early mathematics and eventually culminated with Isaac Newton, whom you all heard about, who along with another German person invented Leibniz. He invented calculus. So then let's, I wanted to show you a video here. So what Galileo had said is that regardless of how big you, an object is, you could take a huge bowling ball, and he took an actual bowling ball, but bowling wasn't a sport those days. These were chains that people would be chained to and a big ball of that. And he took that up to the top of the Leaning Tower of Pisa, and he took another little thing and he dropped the two from the Leaning Tower of Pisa and they dropped to the ground at the same time. And he said, well, I predicted to you that they would drop to the ground at the same time, even though one is much bigger and the other is much smaller. And so that should teach you to trust what I say. Because at the same time when Galileo was alive, there was a lot of opposition in society and in politics about, you know, everything that the scientists and the astronomers and the mathematicians were saying. And they wanted to, you know, they actually imprisoned Galileo. And a side note, I didn't put that picture in here, but the Italians actually took off some of Galileo's fingers. And there is a thing in the museum in Florence where they have actually put his middle finger into the museum. They've displayed his middle finger sort of to say, well, here, I proved it. Anyway, so when people went up to the moon, so what you're seeing here is the Apollo 15 mission and humans on the moon. And I'll just show you quickly this video where Neil Armstrong did this experiment. I think it was Neil Armstrong, but I might be wrong about that. So on one hand, and there's no sound here, on one hand, he has a hammer. If you look carefully on the right hand, he sees a hammer. Rina, do you see the video? Just tell me if it's not.
Yes.
Yeah, thanks. So he has a hammer in his right hand and a feather in his left hand. And this is an experiment that I still do in my freshman classes. And I say, well, I have this hammer or an object, large object and a feather. I'm going to let them go at the same time. Which one will reach the ground first? And of course, most people say the hammer because it's heavier. But as you can see in this experiment that he does there, both touch the ground at the same time. So essentially what they recorded at that time from the moon was that Galileo was right. And that the reason that doesn't work on the earth is that the feather floats on air. And so it reaches later. So that was, so the night sky, back to that, that's how people looked at the night sky, collected lots of data, and I'm short-circuiting a lot of the information here, a lot of the story there, very exciting if you ever want to learn about it, and figured out how to make sense of the universe and the way things work just by collecting huge amounts of data. And in those days, you would call this big data because generations of notebooks. Then came data science version 2. And this was in physicists in the early 1900s through the late 1900s, started to wonder how particles, how atoms and so on are, what are they composed of and what are protons and neutrons and so on. And so what they did was they created something like what you're seeing here, and using large electric fields and magnetic fields and so on, they accelerated these particles to a point where they were moving almost as fast as the speed of light, a fraction of the speed of light. And then they would collide with other particles. So as they collided, you would get fragments of particles coming out and would generate huge amounts of data, the 1940s, 50s, 60s, huge, huge amounts of data, which they did not know, you know, at that point, they had to figure out how to manage that data. So at that point, these physicists, astronomers, the modern astronomers and these particle physicists, they said, well, we have to build new science. We have to build new mathematics and computers to be able to solve these problems. So together with the mathematicians and computer scientists of the early days, these physicists came through and figured out what I would call data science version two. So that was getting big data, and you cannot imagine how big this data is, although it might not be as big as we call them today, but those data would be sent across the internet. And as a college student in the 80s, I would see the older computers sitting on my campus and little tapes and magnetic tapes that would record some of the data that would come across from some of these accelerators. And Europeans did most of that work in the early days because European nations are politically more willing to invest in scientific investigation compared to, let's say, our own country. So a lot of those early days, the work was done at CERN in Geneva and in Switzerland and so on. But the point I'm making here is that you can imagine when little particles like atomic nuclei and so on explode or become little small other pieces, they are detected all over by various detectors, and then there is information about their speed, about their momentum, about their energy, about what color they're giving out and things like that. And so these huge amounts of data had to be made sense of, and that is what I am calling data science version two. So physicists were very active in data analytics and data predictions using large amounts of data in the early 1900s through the late 1900s. And I'll call that version two. So that's the part of the story that I'm hoping I'll unfold for you. So data science and analytics version two, here's a picture of CERN, one of those tunnels in which you accelerate particles typically in a ring or in a straight line. And so you go, let them go around and around and around in that chamber, which is very, very high vacuum. I mean, there's very little other air molecules in there. And so you speed them up to the point where they can actually destroy other particles, other atoms. And this work is what led eventually, as many of you know, to the idea of nuclear power and nuclear atomic weapons. So the fact that when an atom splits or when two atoms fuse, they give out lots of energy, and that you can use that energy either to, you know, kill people, break cities, or to also use that in a controlled fashion to generate electricity in our homes. So this is the type of work that led to that, and that came out of big data science and big data analytics. So that's what I'm calling version two or phase two in our history of data science. Version two was also astronomy. For example, here on the UW-Milwaukee campus, we have a group of people who study what happens when in the sky you have two, say, neutron stars. Neutron stars are things that when a star collapses and becomes really small, the mass of the star sort of attracts each other and becomes a very tiny object that is extremely dense. That is, a teaspoonful of that neutron star would be heavier than the Earth is. So that these two neutron stars often can go around and around, and if they're close by, they will combine into one single point. And this can also happen with what we call black holes, which are like extremely heavy, extremely gravitation intense stars. So, or objects in the sky. So here is a video. So this is how neutron stars coalesce together into one, and then you see a black hole. So now, how is this collected? This information is collected by the fact that we know from basic physics that when an object far away, which is heavy enough, moves in a certain way, it generates a gravitational wave. And that gravitational wave, as it passes through the Earth, actually can imagine if a gravitational wave were passing through me. Actually, you're seeing a video of an image of one of the predictors of this, a Nobel laureate. But as the gravitational wave passes through me, I'm going to become a little bit taller and a little bit shorter. Okay, so if my length changes as a gravitational wave passes through me, then I should be able to detect it. Now, the thing is that changes so little that, you know, you won't see it, of course. And it's so little that you would have to make me miles and miles long. And a tiny change in that huge length of several miles is what you will detect. And the way you would detect it is by putting a mirror on one end of an object and the other end of the object and send some light beams back and forth. And then by looking at how those light beams become shorter or longer and how they interfere, you could tell, oh yeah, a gravitational wave just passed by. And this is very recent stuff detected in 2016. So, but to be able to do that, you have to generate that little movement of the mirrors and the little change in the way in which light passing through those mirrors interferes. And now that measurement generates huge amounts of data. And to the point where there are large numbers, I think something like 30 or 40 groups around the world in Europe, as well as in the US and in other places in India currently. And there are other sites that are being created, that these groups are getting together to process that big data that's coming in. All right, and so what they do, and here is where I need to explain where physics comes in. So physicists have models of the way things work, whether you're talking of the quantum mechanics of a material, which is what I work on, or the way in which black holes and neutron stars get together. You are looking at certain features of the universe that you can write down in mathematical form. And most of us, what we do is that we work between the mathematical form that we have and the data that we're collecting, and we try to merge the two. And so if the mathematics, that is the algebra part of the mathematics, if that agrees with what we are seeing, then we say, aha, we have understood something well. And that is still what we call what I'm calling data science version two. Now, because physicists did all this over the past few centuries, they noticed that some of these techniques were also being applied to business, right, and to economics and so on. And the story that I wrote in the abstract is to say that they didn't jump in, because early data analytics in business were, they'd look at it and say, there's nothing new to be gained here. First of all, okay, you make some money, all right, but what do you understand about the universe? So data science, so physicists at that time, although they were doing a lot of data science, were hesitant to jump in and participate in this big revolution that was taking place in what we call modern data science. And they also said that, not only that's not physics, I mean, making money is important, but they would also say that we know this very well. There's nothing to be learned here that we don't teach in physics and math classes, right? So that was the attitude that physicists had in the late 1900s and the early 2000s. And so for quite a while, they didn't jump in and say, oh, I'm a data scientist. They would say, all right, you're using our techniques, but go ahead and use data science separately. And then now we come to what I would call data science version. Actually, I've written two here, but actually I mean phase three. So phase three, this is when physicists came back to data science. And this happened when machine learning took over and artificial intelligence started to be able to predict things. And the reason that people came by is that, and actually I'm in the editable part of this, so I'm going to change that. And so the reason people came back to data science in the modern version of it, machine learning and artificial intelligence, is that when you have very, very complex situations, like in this case, the atmosphere of the Earth, I'll describe this to you in a minute. But when you have such complex situations, you cannot really make sense of it through simple, what we call closed mathematics, right? There's just too many equations going on. There's like hundreds of equations, thousands maybe of equations that you have to work with. And yeah, you could use older techniques and work with those equations and get some data from it. But then what if you could use patterns and recognize those patterns and use that to predict what might be? So initially physicists started to use data science and machine learning to narrow down the data that was coming through from their experiments to a point where they could now make some sense of it using traditional physics techniques. Remember, physicists want to understand the world, right, and how things work. So now let me just explain what's going on in this video. So this is the Earth, you see a tiny layer of atmosphere surrounding that. In reality, that atmosphere is not as high as it seems in this picture. It's enlarged. It's actually, like a little thin saran wrap, as thick as maybe if you wrap a saran wrap on an orange. So that's the thickness of this atmosphere. But in that atmosphere, you have these large rivers, we call them rivers of moisture, that are traveling through the Earth. So you can see somewhere here they're causing a vortex, somewhere they're flowing through the oceans, they're picking up heat, light, heat and energy and so on. So, and this is what we call physics-driven machine learning and physics-driven data science, in my mind, phase three. Because now you're dealing with such a complex system that when you start seeing visualizing something and you say, aha, there's a vortex starting there, you can start predicting. So atmospheric science and many people in those fields are also in the past 10 years or 20 years jumping back into this. So here's another very recent application of data science that got me excited. So I wanted to show that to you, a modern application of data science. And in there, you know, we're handling thousands of or terabytes of data, huge amounts of data. That's actually larger than the data that might come from the business world. So, and here what's being done is that you pick up little data points from the, you divide the atmosphere into little voxels, into little cubes. And that's also what's happening in this case. You divide the atmosphere into little cubes, which have a certain velocity, a certain, you know, temperature, a certain energetics and things like that. And then using those little voxels, you what I'm talking about are little cubes of air at a certain height. And you take all of that and you say, okay, so this one's moving that direction, that one's moving that direction, this is moving faster, that's moving slower, this is hotter than the other one. And you use all of that information to predict weather. And so that kind of science is now being used to predict how, a lander is going to land on Mars with human beings on it. So here's a simulation, but actual simulation using huge amounts of data on these large computers that, and these computers, by the way, have started to look like the ones that were in the 50s. They fill entire rooms with air conditioning and things like that. And so here on the surface of Mars, you're seeing a little dot in the top left. That's, okay, so what I was saying here, and apologies again, is that you see this atmosphere on top of the Earth, and you're looking at these arrows, these little lines of cold and warm air moving in certain directions. And based on that, and based on how much humidity content that has, and what direction it is, and what temperature it is, you can model what kind of weather, what kind of climate you're going to have at different parts of the Earth. As we all know, climate has been changing significantly. There's fires and floods and so on that are going on. So we use this tool to predict what's going on, where there might be a tornado, where there might be a certain thing forming. And the data now comes from satellites, which are watching and calculating the speed and temperature and humidity of the air that surrounds the Earth. And that's done using infrared cameras and things like that, which can tell you what temperature a certain part of the atmosphere is. Note that the atmosphere, as it's not as thick as it seems here. It's a little thinner than that. Think of a seven wrap around the Earth. That's as how thin the atmosphere really is. So that's what I would call phase three. And what phase three is doing, there are two parts of it in my mind. One is that the amount of data that we can handle is very, very large. And the other thing that's happening is that we are able to predict based on patterns what can happen in the future. So the phase two types of experiments that we used to do have now started relying on phase three types of experiments, where we can use data to predict what's happening and then check with our models, right? So that physicists still have the mindset that we understand the universe in ways that cannot be predicted just by looking at patterns, right? Okay, there was a flood there, so there'll be a flood here. That sort of thing, correlation and physicists are much more interested in causation than correlation, let's put it that way. So here is a human carrying pod that's trying to land on Mars. And this is actually looking at what would happen on the surface of Mars, because we have some idea about the atmosphere now. We have some idea about what sorts of temperature and what part of Mars. So this is, 22 terabytes of data. It's a particular software that people have come up with. And you see the sun from Mars on the top left. And here is a pod that's landing on Mars and telling us what it would look like. a couple seconds ago, you saw this picture of the computers that are processing this one here. And looking at that, if you, especially my academic ancestors who used to do experiments like that, would remember that those days we had computers that were, you know, filled entire rooms and halls, and they used to get so warm that the hall had to be air conditioned. And then very quickly, what we needed an entire room or entire building for, we can now today do it on a laptop or even on our phone. But then we have gone back to this sense of where we want to manage large terabytes of data. And at the same time, so we are going back to some of those computers, except that these are clusters of computers that are as fast and as much capacity as we have today, but that we're using several of those back in a room that is, again, has to be cooled with air conditioning. So this is some of the stuff that are being done for physics by physicists using modern data science, the techniques that have been developed. Here they're changing the color of the hot air that is here, and that color tells us what kind of air is moving where. So you can do all kinds of simulations with it using imagery. So the phase three is where you're able to handle, the techniques have come out, math, computer science, and other techniques have come out thanks to the drive from the business world, which are now, again, useful to physicists. And the data that the observatories used to do, this is the one in University of Oregon. This is the one in Madison. You should go take a look at it. It, by the way, wanted to say it costed $3,000 per year over 3 years to build this entire observatory. Almost any one of us could afford that. But the governor in 1977, Governor Washburn, decided to do that and put that money in at Madison. So Madison, UW-Madison had a head start on this. So we are currently in the phase of what I call people call physics-informed machine learning, which is what I showed you here, and the phase of trying to understand climate change by using digital twins. So here's an atmospheric river that we're watching on a digital twin, and you'll see the twin in a minute. So this is the actual image of the Earth. This is just a part of the video to say that there are floods. So here is the digital twin that people are working on, trying to get the two together to predict how the climate will change in the next few years. So this is, again, back to machine learning, back to big data, back to processing large amounts of data using data that's coming from the satellites that you're seeing here. So they called it forecast, but it's actually FORE forecast. So I am going to say a few more words and stop for questions just to keep time. I wanted to show to you one other thing very quickly, and what is the big math portion of the data science? And I wanted to connect with that very quickly for you. So if most of you from your high school math, you might remember that if you wrote an equation like y equals x squared, then that your teacher would have told you is an equation of a parabola. If you took college calculus, of course, this is elementary for you, college algebra or calculus. But the point that is to be made here is that where is the bottom of that parabola? Suppose you wanted to ask that, right? And so then what you would do, and there could be a minimum in the parabola, that's y equals x squared, or a maximum in the parabola, as in the right side, where y is equals minus x squared. So physicists love writing equations like this, where everything is nice and steady. But as I was saying, the amount of information coming in is becoming so large that it's not anymore, it's hard, difficult to actually put them down into equations. So think about, suppose you had a picture like this. So you have some kind of equation of y versus x, and we call y the function of x. So as you change x, y changes. And here you have a function where you have a maximum and a minimum and a maximum and a minimum and so on, and a saddle point where there's neither maximum nor minimum. And you want to find out where the local maximum is, minimum is, or where the maxima are. So the way we use this very basic math, and I want to describe that to you without going into the math, is that we find the slope of that graph. And we know from intuition that when the slope becomes zero, you're at the maximum or the minimum, right? Slope that goes through a zero is a max or a min. And fortunately for us, Newton, 300 years ago, gave us calculus. And using calculus, we can figure out where the maximum is and where the minimum is, because the derivative, that's what you learn in the first few weeks of calculus semester one, or in high school, the derivative is can be calculated. So if you know an equation, you can then find its slope and say, aha, that's where the maximum is, that's where the minimum is. So physicists have used techniques like this forever, because most things can be written down in an equation where you have the total energy of a system. And we have this sort of assumption, which always has turned out to be right, is that everything wants to minimize energy. So if we can write down an equation where you put energy on the y-axis and all the other parameters on the x-axis, and if you can find where the minimum is, then you can say, aha, that's right, because any system wants to go down to its lowest energy state. But now imagine you have multiple parameters like this. So it's not a two-dimensional graph, but a three-dimensional graph, right? Now what do you do? And let's say it's not three-dimensional. Let's say it's 100-dimensional graph. So as long as three dimensions, we have some techniques that we can use. But when you get to 100 dimensions, those techniques start to fail. And this is a very basic concept that you learn in a data science course. And that is that how do you find where the minima are? Because a lot of the solutions are in the minimum. Let's say on the y-axis, especially if you were working with Northwestern Mutual, you want to see where the losses are the lowest, right? You want to see where, let's say, the inflation is the lowest and things like that, and then make your decision as to where to invest. So what this technique is telling you is that if you can put these very various parameters into a multidimensional space, then all you have to do is find the minimum. Now, it's not easy to find a minimum here. So people have developed in 50 years ago, many physicists and mathematicians developed what's called a random walk technique. In a random walk technique, you just go sample as if you were walking on the surface, and you sample various things, places, and you say, aha, here seems like there's a minimum. Let me just walk along that slope and see where do I reach the bottom of that valley. And so what you do computationally is that reach that bottom of the valley, and then you say, look, inflation or profit or loss or whatever has reached a maximum or a minimum, and that's where we need to go. So most data scientists who are telling you what to do are using this technique. So here they're using a technique that's actually simplified here. Now, many of you came to this talk and said, okay, all that is good, data science, physics, math, and all of that. That's not why I came here. What in the world is an Ouroboros? Ouroboros? Why did you put that in the title? You might be asking that. Well, that's a term that came up from Greek, and they exist in other languages as well. And it's the idea of a snake eating its own tail. And in the early days, it was used to say that, well, this is, you know, the universe is basically a cyclic thing. Everything goes up and comes back. And in some senses, physicists, although they were sort of early data scientists, and they did not jump into onto the bandwagon of data science in the early days, but now they have come back to it. So in a sense, I meant to say that a snake is eating its own tail. By the way, that concept was sometimes described, I think this is the Chinese concept, where a snake is eating its own tail in that shape. And that's the shape that gave the world the sign for infinity. So you can, you know, get onto this and you can go around and around as like a Möbius strip, and you do that forever. So that's the idea of infinity. So with that, I'll stop, and Dr. Ghosh, we could go to questions, or you wanted to talk about next frontiers. Go ahead.
There is a brief survey that will come on, but I also wanted to just mention that there is a number of events coming up. NMDSI inaugural symposium, Untapped AI. Please go ahead and do a speaker series polling survey.
I feel like a professor getting student evaluations here.
um, I think if we are done with the survey, then just to mention this Untapped AI Next Frontiers Symposium is on April 13th. And visit nmdsi.org for registration and more information. There's another speaker, if we go to the next slide. Yes, and on May 5th, we have a talk, an exploration of data science and analytics at UWM. So with that, we'd like to open up for questions.
I pulled up the questions on the screen, if that's okay. Mostly, thank you for the compliments. There's one question. Should I read it out, Maria? Dear Dr. Guptasarma, if I'm going to do research using space-related data with data science under my bachelor's degree, how should I start? Can you explain the roadmap? I would say if you have a bachelor's degree in data science, then I would say take a few physics classes, maybe not all of them, and then try to get a job with NASA or with SpaceX and things like that if you want to do research using space-related data. Or you could join one of the departments right here, physics and computer science and so on, which do similar kinds of research. Feel free to write to me. My email is pg@uwm.edu. I want to take a class with Dr. Guptasarma when I retire. Oh, you could do that right now. Thank you. thank you. It's a very interesting presentation. I'm sorry about all the technical difficulties we had. What do you imagine is going to be the next frontier for data science version 4? I would say that version 4 would be where the citizen data science will start taking over, because the techniques of processing will become so powerful that we would have data that is publicly available, maybe not data for profit and loss, but all other kinds of things. And then a person, anyone in this audience could go on there and start using a free software to process it on their little computer, on their laptop. So that's going to be the next frontier. And that's when real, I believe, real movement will occur, because we will then no longer be limited to people like me, you know, who have been in college for a long time and then, you know, get a short few decades to do work. But that if everybody gets involved and discovers new things, then that's when I think when data science version 4 will start. Do you have open PhD positions? Please write to me, pg@uwm.edu. Yes, the answer is yes. Career preparations. So any information on career preparations? The question is from Victor. I would say, Victor, the basics of data science, of course, is mathematics. So if you are interested in creating new data science techniques, then learning basic math. You don't have to go very far ahead in math, but learning basic math, maybe 3 semesters of calculus are important. And then that's going to train you to understand the algebra that people use, and maybe a semester of statistics. And then you could go into any master's in data science. We have one right here at UWM, a little shameless plug for Dr. Ghosh, who's the director of that program. And so, you know, you could get a master's from here and then off you go. I think data science has been named the sexiest career currently in 2023. So if you learn even a little bit of it, you can go anywhere with huge, typically, I think they're well over, what is the word? 6 figures of jobs, salaries. Thank you, Gautam. Any information on career preparation? That's the same question again. So yes, as I said, learn basic math, and that will help. Mary is asking, so were physicists bored with the progression of data science? Is that why they left the field, because the field was not providing complex problems? I don't think they were bored. They were saying that, well, these are stuff we know. We teach this stuff. in regular physics classes. Our PhD students and our researchers use these techniques, and it's great that it's becoming useful in the business world. But we'll watch, and I think many people, including myself, watched the progression of data science in the past 10 to 20 years, and how important it has become, and how it made sense in the way that, say, Northwestern Mutual uses it. But they were not bored. You could say bored in a way that it's not giving insight into the world around us, because that's what drives most of us as physicists. We want to use it to figure out how things work. And if that leads us to new techniques, great. And that's what actually happened. Given that systems, question from Evan Carrigan, systems of interest exhibit sensitive dependence on initial conditions, it seems unlikely that any model would do more than approximate the real world. How then does one tell which of the approximately matching models is correct? There is no way. I mean, the key is observing it finally. So the question is, if it's so complex, how do you even figure out what will happen? And because it's become so complex, it's become difficult to write down equations and say, okay, we have a universal law or a principle or a theorem that describes it. It's too complex to describe in using old techniques. So we say, well, we'll observe patterns in the data. We will do pattern matching, and then we'll say, we will try to predict what's happening. And then if that prediction turns out to be true, then we say, okay, our pattern matching was correct. Physicists are still, and mathematicians to some extent, are still a little bit skeptical about that method, because what that uses is correlation and not insight, right? But the point here is that in phase three, which I'm nobody else calls it that, so don't use it anywhere else, but in phase three, we are using the correlation to let us drive in toward causation. So that's an insight into the world. How do you feel about coding boot camps? Are they effective in training? Definitely. There's coding boot camps that occur right here on UWM campus and many other places. There's also on the internet. So any coding that you can learn, as long as you have also learned basic math, algebra and calculus, basically, coding is very useful.
Could I interrupt just one second for sure. Those seeking the career guidelines? We have an excellent program in data science and analytics, and our website includes our courses. And you can see that the kinds of questions Dr. Guptasarma is answering, that information is there as well. And of course, May 5th, there is a talk about it. Thank you.
So stay engaged with this excellent series. And I want to thank the Northwestern Mutual Data Science Institute for inviting me to give this talk. And thank you, Veena, for reaching out. And I want to encourage everyone in this audience to stay connected with science and with what science is doing for you. I'll stop there.
Thank you so much. That was a wonderful talk. We will be ending our session now. Thank you all for attending, and please visit our next present series of presentations and events. Goodbye for now.
Bye.